Hi Ben, how you doing?
Hello Paul, how you doing?
Thanks. Good to finally speak to you after I don't know how many years we've been connected.
I think we've been Facebook friends for a long time, but we only recently started talking because I saw the trailer for your documentary.
Right, yeah. So what did you think of it?
Well, crazy. I mean, I'm pretty open-minded. I'm not the kind of person that just dismisses stuff. I mean, I don't know. You know, this stuff could be true as far as I'm concerned. I'm open to anything. And so, do you want to go ahead and introduce and tell our listeners what all this is about?
So in 2007, I made a documentary film called Your Worst Nightmare. And during the interview process for that documentary film, a lot of the people, in fact, most of them, were describing strange encounters. Some would report hearing shuffling footsteps. Some would report, you know, they would see entities in the room, shadow forms. And some would even report being physically assaulted by these shadowy forms. And there was a whole host of other things that people witnessed during the sleep paralysis episode. And for your listeners, you know, who don't know what sleep paralysis is, sleep paralysis, it affects 1 in 5 people worldwide. So 1 in 5 people, if you're together, ask, has anyone ever woken up unable to move or cry out, but you're awake and you can see and hear everything. And I guarantee you, one person will put up their hand and say, that has happened to me. Mm. But a lot of people refuse to discuss it because, A, they don't know what it is, and B, it sounds crazy. So they don't want to be ridiculed or laughed at, or, you know, people think they're crazy. So we were finding that these people, after, you know, they had trust in us, they were, telling us all about these experiences, these strange otherworldly experiences they were having. And shadow people or shadowy figures seemed to be a recurrent theme. And they were all describing similar types of beings or entities. So my documentary at that point wasn't about shadow people. So I decided to, you know, collate those interviews, and I would plan to use them at a later date in another documentary, actually looking into the subject of shadow people. And that's something that was personal to me because I have had experiences myself with that phenomena. But I didn't know, you know, when I first had it, what it was, because the internet didn't exist back then. So you couldn't search it unless you went to the library. And then what do you call it? You walk into the library, you don't know what to look for. So I had no idea until the age of the internet what had happened to me and what I had seen. So that kind of is what sparked me to create this new documentary called Supernatural Assault. And, you know, it was just by chance it happened.
Mm. Paul, I want to ask you what your first paranormal experience was, but I just want to interject to say a couple of things. I've had that experience where you wake up in paralysis and you can't move. I've had it very, very rarely, maybe just the odd occasions through my life. And I've never had the sensation that was anything supernatural. I didn't feel like there was a being in my presence, anything like that. But I've had it where I almost felt like my neck was restricted and I couldn't breathe and couldn't move. It didn't spook me out or anything. I figured maybe just, I don't know what it was, but I just wanted to say, yeah, I've had that experience. But the second thing that it made me think of when you were talking, I was dating a girl once, and she'd had these full on experiences, like is the subject matter of your documentary. She said, no, Pete, there's an old lady that comes and sits on my bed and people think I'm mad, and I'm telling you it's real, you know, like nobody believes, you know, everyone thinks you're crazy, but there's like three different characters and everyone that has these experiences reports the same or very similar characters that comes to them. Does that resonate with what you know to be true, Paul?
It does, and that's exactly what was happening with these people that we were interviewing. And what your girlfriend or ex-girlfriend was describing was what they termed the old hag. And that term kind of evolved out of the area of Newfoundland, and which is off the coast of the US. And it used to come from the term, they used to describe it as a witch. They used to call it a witch, and it would ride you. And, you know, you'd be laying on your back, and it, it would appear on your chest. And a lot of people report feeling a heaviness or a pressure on the chest. Some people even report, like it happened to me, you feel the sensation that you're being depressed into the mattress. So it feels like a really heavy, you know, unknown forces on top of you. And they used to term it, they used to call it the old hag. And they used to say that it was because you were being ridden by the hag. And it came out of, you know, the old folklore, but it that term caught on. And that's what people describe when they describe that particular entity, the hooded, lady-like, old-type figure, and it's shadowy as well. And that's where that term comes from. And that's very, very popular. And that actually is shown in the documentary film.
So where did this start for you? How old were you? Because I've heard some of your interviews when you first had a strange experience. How old were you and what happened?
Yeah, my first encounter with one of these shadowy entities happened when I was around 5 going on 6. I used to live in southwest London in a place called Fulham. And then we moved from there to Shepherd's Bush. On the Askew Road, there's a block of flats there called Becklow Gardens. And so we got a flat there. And it was me and my parents, and my sister was very young at that point. But I had my own bedroom at the end of the flat, and my parents were about 12 to 15 feet away from me in their bedroom. But what used to happen was I'd wake up at night, and I would see this tall, silhouetted, shadowy figure standing right beside my bed, right beside my face, literally, and it was looking down at me, and its hands were in a kind of a downward position and together, as if it was in a prayer position, like it was just praying over me. I don't know. That's the only way I can describe the position it was standing in. And I looked up at this thing, and I used to describe it to my mom. I used to scream. And my mom would come running into the room, and I would tell her that I just seen this tall lady standing next to me. She was all black, and she had an afro. That's the way I described it. Now, I was only 5 going on 6, and in the 70s, the afro was the thing. I had one myself, so I figured, you know, that's what it was. But what's strange about this story is we moved out of that apartment. We were only there not even a year, and my parents moved to another place, which was a much nicer place. And that apartment was, or that flat was given to my cousins. So my uncle and aunt moved in with my cousin, Leon, who was around my age. He was about a year younger than me. And he moved into my bedroom. And what's strange about this is when I was making the documentary Supernatural Assault, I reconnected with Leon. I hadn't spoken to him since I left, or before I left England, actually. So it was well over 20 years. So we reconnected on Facebook during the time I was making the film. And I said to him, yeah, Leon, I'm making this film about, you know, the paranormal. And I hadn't even told him what it was about. And I said, I have a question for you. And there's a reason I didn't tell him what it was about, because I wanted to see if he had, you know, seen anything in that house. And I said to him, Leon, when you took my bedroom over in Becklow Gardens, I said, did you see anything strange in that room at nighttime? And he just went crazy. I mean, his reaction was almost as if I'd insulted him. He was like, why are you saying that? You know, what made you say that? And I said to him, I'm just asking you a question, you know, it's a simple question. Did you see anything? And he said, I've never spoken about it to anyone. And he said to me, and I nearly dropped when he said it, that he was visited at night by a tall, shadowy figure that wore a hat. And what was bizarre about that, it kind of struck a chord. What if what I was describing as an afro was actually a hat? I don't know. But the fact that my cousin had seen the same thing in the same room as I had at around the same age was uncanny.
Yeah, and that makes sense why it would freak him out, because with you having the same experience, that pretty much verifies it as being real. I guess he could just pass it off as his imagination or something, but with you saying you've seen the same thing, it kind of brings a reality to it then, doesn't it?
Yeah, it did, and it did for me too, because I was kind of I, like I said, I could have dropped. I just, you know, I had chills and everything. I just thought, what the hell? Did I really see that as a child? Because a lot of children see things that, you know, the adults will say, oh, it's just your imagination. And I thought for years, maybe that's what it was. But when he, and it was real. Let me tell you how real it was, Ben. That event was so real to me as a child that to this day, I'm 49 now. To this day, I refuse to sleep with my face uncovered. I will pull the blanket or duvet up over my face to cover it, and I'll make it a hole so I can breathe, or I put a pillow over my head. And I do this even in the hot sun, like when it's, or the hot summers. And that's the type of effect it had on me. I refuse to sleep with my face uncovered because I do not want anything looking down at me when I'm sleeping. And that's, you know, that's the effect it left, or the scars, it, mental scars it left on me.
Presumably, somewhere along the line, you started speaking to other people about this. And did you, at that point, start to hear other similar stories from other people?
Well, not stories as similar as that. During my youth growing up, I never really spoke about it. I didn't. You know, the odd occasional time it would come up, but it wasn't something I ever really spoke about. It wasn't until my second experience that I started speaking about this type of stuff. And I didn't know at that time to call it shadow people. I just thought it was maybe a ghost, an apparition. I didn't know what it was. And the second event was, that was the one that really shocked me, because it wasn't just me that saw it. There was me and someone else witnessed the exact same thing, and we had no connection to each other. We didn't know each other, you know, previously from anywhere. So, and again, when I saw the second entity, whatever it was, the internet wasn't around, so I still didn't know what to call it. I didn't know what it was. But then after that experience, yes, I was telling everybody about it, and I had heard people, you know, not many, just maybe one or two people say they had seen stuff similar, but it wasn't the way they described it to me. It didn't seem as similar. It's not until I came to the States, I came across a lot more people that had actually seen these things and described them exactly as I had seen it.
So what was the second experience that you alluded to?
Yeah, the second experience happened in the late 80s. And I worked up at Scotland Yard. I used to work in the printing rooms on the 15th floor. Oh. And I worked up there for about just under 2 years. But what happened was, one of my work colleagues came around. She was from another department completely, but she came around and said, we're organizing this after work ghost tour. We've done one previously, and I had heard all about it, and it sounded really cool. And I had an interest in the paranormal. I was just hooked on it. I used to get all the all the VHS films and watch them, and I'd seen everything there was. So I was well into ghosts and all of that stuff. So I said, yeah, I'll go. So a bunch of us from my department signed up, and we met up one evening after work in the pub, and we waited for the coach to arrive. And then we all boarded this 52-seater coach and headed off on the first leg of the tour to, I think we went to some pub up in East London somewhere. I can't even remember the name of it. But we were all excited. And then towards the end of the night, the lady said, you know, who was doing the tour, that we're going to take you to the Chislehurst Caves. And I'd never heard of those before. I didn't know what they were. So we went to the caves, and then we all, you know, went to the front entrance, and they handed us these lamps. They're like, almost like they look like old vintage lamps. And we all went down into the cave. So the tour guide at one point was telling us a story about some guys who'd done a challenge, and they stayed in the caves on their own overnight. And he played us the cassette recording of what happened to them. And it was quite horrific. And, you can probably hear that tape online if you want to search on YouTube, because I have heard it on there. And then he started describing zero light photons, telling us there's zero light photon, you know, photons down here. And I hadn't heard that term before. And so he said, I'm going to show you, you've probably never experienced it, what it's like to be in an environment with zero light photons. So he told everyone on the count of three to turn off your lamps. And we did. And the only way to describe it, and I've said this before on other podcasts and stuff, the only way to describe this is as if somebody has just taken the eyes from your head and you are rendered blind instantly because you can't perceive anything. So we're in total blackness. And these caves, the Chislehurst Caves, are carved out of chalk. So when you do have a lamp on, you can see pretty well. But anyway, the tour continued, and we ended up in a place where there used to be an old well shaft that went up to the surface, and it was blocked off. But the tour guide was talking all about the well shaft and its history, and I was at the back of the group, and next to me stood a lady, and I never knew her. She was, you know, somebody had brought her along. She was a friend of one of my colleagues. And all of a sudden, as the tour guide was giving his talk, I had the sensation I needed to turn around, almost like something was watching me. So I turned around and I looked towards the end of the cave, which was a dead end. And what I saw there was as if somebody was standing down there, dragging on a cigarette. You couldn't see any shapes, figures, or anybody, but you could just see an orange ember, and it started to glow brighter and brighter. And that's what it looked like, someone dragging on a cigarette. So I looked at it for a moment, and then I saw another one appear, and then another one. So there was three of them in a triangular formation, one at the top and two down below. And I tapped the lady next to me, who turns out she was from Germany. She was over on holiday. I tapped her on the shoulder and I said, "Hey, have a look at that. What's that?" So she turned around and we're both standing there holding our lamps, looking down the cave. And all of a sudden, these embers, or the glowing light, started to rotate anti-clockwise, and they got faster and faster. And we just kept watching them, thinking, you know, what is this, a light show or something? And then all of a sudden, they stopped dead. And one of them, the top one, went higher to the top of the cave, and the two bottom ones went down towards the ground level. So it was as if the triangle opened up. And from the center of that formation jumped a small black silhouetted shadowy figure, and it looked like a say a 14, 15 year old kid in a diving suit. That's the height it was. It wasn't really tall. It was about 5 feet, 4.5 feet, 5 feet tall, and it jumped out of the center and landed on its feet in a sort of a crouching position. You know, like you see the ninjas running around these kung fu films. It was like that, and its hands were up, and it was looking around its environment. So it had one hand in front of it and one sort of behind it. And it was looking around the whole cave as if it was, you know, exploring or looking at its environment. But it didn't see us. We were standing right in front of it about 30 feet away, and it didn't see us. And I looked at the German lady, and as I turned to look at her, she just let out an almighty scream. And it was like ear-piercing scream. She was terrified. And when she'd done that, I looked right back at the creature, whatever it was, and its head whipped around and it looked straight at us as if that's the first time it saw us. Then it turned to its left and it ran straight through the cave wall. I mean, a solid wall. It just went through that wall as if it didn't exist. And I ran straight after it. I wasn't scared at that point because I thought it was a trick. I thought it was some projection or something like that, an illusion. And I ran down there. And I'm holding my lamp, looking up for a projector or some source that could have projected that into the cave. And I could see nothing. And within 15, 20 seconds, I was back towards the group. And they were all around this German lady. The tour guide was there. And one of her friends was consoling her. And she was shaking. So I had to tell them what we had just seen. And the tour guide said to me, "That thing has been seen down in this cave on numerous occasions."
Really?
So, yeah, he said, "When you go upstairs, there's a logbook up there." He goes, "I'll ask them for the logbook at the desk, and both of you fill out your experience." So we did. We went up to the desk and filled out into the logbook, which was thick. It was about, you know, an inch thick of experiences that people had had down there.
Wow.
And yeah, and we exchanged our details, because she asked me for my address, because I, you know, there was no web back then. So I gave her my address and telephone number, and she said she wanted that because when she goes home and tells this to her friends, she does not want them to think she's nuts, and she's gonna write to me for confirmation. I never heard from her again.
So the fact that multiple people are seeing the same thing eliminates the possibility that you're just imagining it, doesn't it?
Correct. That for me was confirmation. And from that day forward, I knew that these things were real. I mean, it was as real as seeing a person in a costume down there. That's how real it was. And if it had a run down the cave, I probably would have thought it was a person in a costume to this day. But the fact that it ran straight through a chalk wall, you know, a cave wall, said to me that it was not of this world. There was something else to it.
What do you believe it is, Paul?
Well, from all of my, you know, research and time making these documentaries and, you know, all the time since then, all the things I've read online and in books, I really do believe, Ben, in the possibility that there are other life forms that could exist in the same space as us. Because, as you know, we know science can only measure a certain amount of what exists out there. They are, you know, it's 5% of all that exists in the known visible universe they can measure. The rest of it, the 95%, they just collectively term it as, you know, dark matter. They don't know what it is. They just know it's there. So if all that we can perceive exists, you know, in 5% of what the matter there is, what possibly could exist in 95%? And is it possible that, you know, other energetic-based life forms or other forms of life in some way we still don't understand could exist in those areas that we can't measure, and momentarily, you know, they're able to shift down their vibrational frequency and drop into our five sense reality, and that's how we see them? Or there's a weird, you know, scenario that causes our existences to collide, so we momentarily catch a glimpse of each other. Like I said, it didn't see us until she screamed. So what did it react to? Did it react to the visual of us, or did it just hear the sound and run? I don't know. Something happened. But I do believe that there's more to this world we live in and reality and the universe than we know. And I think it's possible that these could be another form of life that exists on an alternate vibrational frequency or another reality or dimension. That's my belief.
When the Bible talks about demons and the Quran talks about the jinn, are they talking about the same things?
Yes, they are. They're just different names. The jinn are, you know, the jinn and demons and all of that go across cultures. They're cross cultures, cross religions. You know, they're just prevalent. They've been around. They're depicted in artworks that go back to the 15th, 16th, and 17th century. They're all over the place. And it's about time people in the West started to take it seriously and just discuss it, at least talk about it, because people shouldn't have to see these things and then not know how to handle it, and then keep it quiet and, you know, go crazy at night when they're trying to get to sleep. That's what causes a lot of sleep paralysis in people. They get that because they just bottle up and they get anxious when they're going to bed, and it just spirals out of control.
Do you think there's a lot of people that have these kind of experiences but they don't talk about it, and so, you know, there's perhaps more people that have these experiences that we don't know about, you know?
There absolutely is. I guarantee that, because when we made the documentary film, there was a number of people who we interviewed that said they don't speak about it to anybody. And they finally, actually, after the interview, we were contacted by people who said that after we were able to talk to you, it stopped, because they finally had a sense that somebody believes them and doesn't think they're crazy, which was why they never spoke about it. But it's also a mental thing, you know. You now know that others have this. You're not abnormal, you know. There's nothing wrong with you. Some of these things are normal human experiences we just can't explain. Like sleep paralysis is well known, you know, they can explain that, but a lot of people who have it for the first time, they think, what the heck, you know, I can't talk about this to anyone. I can't go to the doctor and say that I seen a shadowy entity in my room, or I felt someone jumping on my chest, because this is a true fact. There was a study done when we made our first documentary. We spoke to David J. Hufford, who's one of the leading experts on sleep paralysis in America. He was in the film, And he said that he asked that question to a load of his colleagues who were certified physicians and, you know, psychologists and stuff. And they said that they would, you know, basically medicate that person. They would call, you know, label them psychotic. So what do you do with that? You know, that's why people are afraid to open their mouths. There's nowhere in the West to turn to. Well, there is now, but there wasn't previously. And in the Eastern cultures, they deal with this. They have ceremonies. They have ways to deal with this.
Mm. Is there a difference between ghosts and these entities, or is it all the same thing?
I personally think there is a difference between ghosts and these shadowy entities. I think these shadowy entities are alive. I don't think that they are souls and spirits of people that have passed on. I think that they are as real as me and you, and they have their own lives. But I just feel that somehow, you know, they're able to come or appear in front of us in our reality, and we catch a glimpse of them. One really cool thing that was said by Dr. David Hufford, when we asked him the question about why do they appear in shadow form, he basically stated, and I think it was in the Supernatural Assault as well, if an entity stood in front of you, or a creature from another vibrational frequency that was beyond your visual range stood in front of you, it wouldn't appear invisible like some people think ghosts are invisible. What it would do is it would block the light that was in the room behind it and reflect towards you light that your eyes could not perceive. So it would therefore appear as a black shadow. It would appear black. It wouldn't appear invisible. And that could explain why they appear as shadows. And that's just one theory. I don't know if it's the truth, but that could explain the shadowy form.
I remember when I was at school, my friend's mum had some kind of experience, and she never said much about it. She only said a few words about it, and she wouldn't talk about it. And he told me, she said, one day she saw something in the house, and it terrified her. And the only thing she said is, I've never seen such evil in all my life. And she wouldn't say nothing else about it. She wouldn't talk about it. That's all she said. And, you know, I don't know what happened, but, I never forget that.
It would be interesting to just get a descriptor of what she saw, you know. That would be interesting to see what she saw. Get a description of what she saw so you can kind of see if it's anything like this.
But what a thing to say, because, you know, if it was like a home intruder, like a burglar, she would say, you know, there was a man in the hallway or something, wouldn't she? You know, like, it's a strange thing to say, isn't it?
Yeah, these things are more scary than a home invasion. They're more scary than a burglar, because when they can appear into your home and you can't stop them, I mean, you could be in your bed at night, in your room on your own, and one of these things could appear there in your room, and it somehow it's come through the walls, it's appeared in your room, and then if it attacks you, which some people have been physically assaulted by these things, and then leaves, that's worse, because now you're saying, is it going to come back? You know, am I going to deal with this? Can I go to sleep? Is that thing going to be on me when I wake up? That's more terrifying than a home invasion, I think, because it can come at any time when you least expect it.
Is this essentially the same as a poltergeist, you know, and those kind of stories?
It's a poltergeist with a visual presence. I mean, poltergeist activity, you know, you see things flying around. They've recorded things moving. You can't see anything. That, you know, that I don't think is as scary. That's scary in itself, but I don't think that's as scary as seeing a tall black mass or intruder in the shape of a humanoid in your bedroom that actually climbs on top, you know, on top of you. And some people say it's tried to choke them. We had one interviewee say she was sexually assaulted by one of these things, and there was no joke. This is for real for her, and it affected her so badly that she shied away from having relationships for years over it. So these things are doing things to people that are not cool. But then there are some people who say that, you know, researchers and stuff online that say that there are good and bad ones. There are some that may look out for you. And maybe that's what I experienced when I was a kid. You know, that when I said it was in the prayer position, it was just looking down at me harmlessly. It scared me, but it didn't do anything to me. I don't know what it was. I don't know. You know, my mum was convinced at the time it was some sort of guardian angel looking over me. So people perceive them in different ways, but there are those that are malevolent that will attack, scratch, choke, sexually assault, physically, you know, hit, and you get that. So it's terrifying.
Is there some connection with this and satanic occult ritual stuff to do with, I was seeing some stuff about adrenochrome, which is when like people are terrified and their body releases adrenaline. There's some theories that you know, the elites, the satanic rituals, they do this. And the reason they go after, they terrorize people and drink their blood is because it gives them some kind of high when they ingest, this adrenaline. And, you know, like that Monsters, Inc. kids cartoon film. Yep. Is there some link between that and this?
Well, if you look on the web and stuff, you'll find a lot of people seem to have the belief that these things are attracted to fear, or they feed off of fear. And that fear vibrational frequency that the victim gives off, they crave it, they want it. And I don't know if I told you, Ben, but I was in a film from Anchor Bay Films called Shadow People.
And I didn't know
this film was released in 2014. And what happened when I released my first documentary, not to go off on a tangent, but when I released my first documentary, Your Worst Nightmare, a producer called Matt Arnold saw it. And he contacted me and wanted to see if he could use some of my interviews in his upcoming film, Shadow People. And then we got into a discussion about what they were, and this came up about the fear. That's why I brought this up. And so when I told him my beliefs on it, he wanted me in the film. So they put me in the film. So I'm in that movie. But I used the analogy in that film that these entities, these non-material entities, are attracted to fear, and they can sense the fear just like a shark can detect a drop of blood in the ocean. So people who are there at night sleeping in this depressive, anxious state, you know, afraid to go to sleep because they've seen something, or they're afraid they may see something, are creating this vibrational frequency that attracts these entities to them. And a lot of people seem to believe that that is the energy source that they feed on. And that ties into what you just mentioned. I have heard that when they do these sacrifices and these, you know, or these so-called sacrifices that look like sacrifices without killing people, they drive these people's fear levels up so high that you get that release into the bloodstream of that adrenaline. And that's maybe has some sort of connection to this.
I had a thought that crossed my mind, and this is not necessarily an explanation, but I did wonder, is it possible we can inherit trauma from our ancestors? For example, like, you know, say many generations ago, someone was, you know, physically attacked or something, yeah, traumatized. Can that come through our genes and our DNA? And is it possible we could be haunted by something that our ancestors experienced?
It's interesting. No one's ever asked me that, but here's my opinion on that. I believe, and this is true, DNA they've proven that they can record to DNA. It's actually supposed to be one of the best mediums, the most reliable mediums to record information to. I believe our DNA can be recorded to and can be passed on. So if someone has a traumatic experience, say they were attacked by a dog, you know, and it bit them, their grandchild or their child could grow up with this innate fear of dogs. It happened to my sister. She was terrified of dogs. But they can grow up with these afflictions that have been passed down in their genes. And it's the same thing with animals. You know, they know instinctively when they come out of their mother's womb, like a deer, to run. When they see a certain creature, they know all these things that are dangerous to them. So it would only make sense that somehow in our DNA, the information is being stored there from a past experience that could be associated with danger, fear, or even, you know, death or destruction that will be played out in somebody, and they won't even know why it's happening to them. I think that stuff is possible. I think that you can record those events to DNA and pass them on.
You know, I don't think it necessarily explains all these scenarios you're talking about, but I just wonder if there could be an element of that where we're reliving, you know, an ancestral sort of horror or something.
Yeah, it's possible. I think it's possible myself. I do.
What's the main skeptical point of view on this kind of stuff? Like, what's the best arguments against it? Like, is there kind of psychological explanations that you've heard?
Yeah, because we interviewed some professors and doctors and stuff, and some of them say this is all psychological. You know, it's funny how they're afraid of Paxil, which is a drug that will, you know, combat anxiety and stuff like that at night. But they say that when people, but that would make sense, because if you can alleviate someone's anxiety, you can kind of relax them into a state where they're not giving off that fear vibration. They're not afraid. And maybe some of these people are hallucinating. We just don't know. The thing is, I can't prove that these exist, and science can't prove that they don't. We just don't know. That's why it's healthy to have the discussion and see if we can figure it out together. But there are those who do believe that this is nothing more than a figment of the imagination, and that's where it can kind of get scary for people when it comes time to reporting these, you know, these incidents.
Yeah. And there's certain things like this that is not really viable or possible to study, really, or it's very difficult or just unpractical to study, you know?
Exactly.
I mean, how would you go about doing a scientific measure of this stuff? You know, where would you even begin, and who would even want to fund it? You know, it's so, just because there isn't like a university study to validate this stuff doesn't mean it's not happening.
I know, and there's, you know, put it this way, there's plenty of people out there who have witnessed them, and I've actually got a photograph of one, which I'm going to send it to you, that somebody, I'll tell you the story behind it briefly. I spoke with a paranormal researcher called Polly Gear. She's somewhere down south in the United States, and this was a long time ago, but she was doing a investigation in an old prison, and she went up on her own to one of the levels of the prison and walked into a cell. And when she walked into the cell, she saw in front of her one of these things that I described. It was a silhouette of a humanoid standing there looking out of the bars of the window. There was a little slither window with some bars, and it was looking right out of there. So she walked into the cell, and it didn't hear her, and she shone her flashlight on it. And the strange thing is, when the light beam hit it, it lifted up its arm and put it in the light beam as if it was curious to what that was, and its back was turned to her. So it was studying this light beam as if it was like, what the hell is that? Anyway, she picked up her camera and pressed a button. When it clicked, that thing looked at her, just like the one I saw in the caves. It looked at her really quickly and then ran straight through the wall. It was gone. And then she came down the stairs into the mess hall where the guys would eat their, or the prisoners would eat their meals. And then when she walked down there, she got that sensation to turn around, and she had her camera ready, and she just turned around and snapped. And there was the thing standing right there. And I've got that photograph.
Wow.
I'll send it.
I'd love to see that. Reminds me of another story. I don't know what your thoughts are on extraterrestrials, but I was out to dinner at a friend's birthday party once. There was about 10 of us. I was sat next to this woman, and we were chatting. We got to know each other, and we quickly figured out that we're both pretty open-minded to all kinds of stuff, and spiritual, paranormal, esoteric stuff and all that. And she was telling me, she was in bed, and these, basically, to cut a long story short, these little alien, short little beings kept coming to visit her in her room at night, repeatedly, people. So I took her at her word. You know, I'm not the kind of person that's just going to dismiss something. Who do, you know, what do I know? Maybe it's true. And to cut a long story short, this was happening and happening repeatedly. And she went and consulted with Bashar, Daryl Ankar. Do you know that guy?
No. Is not hold on, I do. Is that the guy that channels?
Yeah, he channels Bashar. Yeah, the guy's name is Daryl, but he channels Bashar,
I've seen it.
who is supposedly an ET. And so he goes into an altered state and sort of anyway. So she went to see him, and he says to her, "Yeah, they're your children. They're coming to visit you. They're your hybrid children. Like, somewhere along the line, your genetic material or your eggs were taken, and they were, somewhere else, they were crossbred with something else, and you've got children that are not of this world, and they come and visit you."
Well, yeah, I've not heard that before, but her story sounds very similar to one of the people we interviewed in our documentary, that they heard these little things coming up the hallway grumbling, and then one of them pounced on the guy when he was sleeping. But it's that is very similar to what people describe when they have sleep paralysis or when they see these shadowy figures in their rooms. But as far as ETs, that's interesting, because what we did find is a lot of people who believe different things will associate these things that they see in their room with what they believe. Like, for instance, if someone's more into the extraterrestrials or believes in extraterrestrials, they tend to say that's what they saw. Some of them even think that they've been probed, abducted, or things happen to them that are all ET based, whereas others who are more spiritual, ghostly, will say it was a ghost, So that tends to, on based on someone's belief system, it tends to reflect what they perceive they saw.
Is there an element of community with this kind of thing? Like, do you regularly stay in contact with other people that have these kind of experiences? Is there online, Facebook groups for this kind of stuff? Is there meetups? Is there conferences, seminars, that kind of thing?
There are people online that have websites that are, dedicated to particular areas. Like, some will have shadow people websites. Then you've got jinn websites. So yeah, there are places you can go if you have something to share or you want to find out more information. You can go to these places, and they do have forums and chat rooms and stuff like that.
I like your approach, Paul. You've got a very level-headed kind of demeanor about you, because you tell you recount the stories of experiences that you've had, and you seem to openly admit, you don't know what it is, you don't know how to explain it, you've got your theories of what it could be, but you're not, you because like when someone is a little bit too certain of what's going on, they come off as a bit crazy, don't they? This is what's happening, and this is what it is. That's a bit off-putting, but I like your approach. You're really just telling your experiences, aren't you?
Yeah, and it like a you know it is it's hard. You like I said earlier, I can't prove that they do exist, but I know what I believe because I saw what I saw, and I didn't see it alone. If I saw that alone in the caves, Ben, I would have probably thought, maybe I imagined that. Maybe that was my imagination, my brain playing tricks on me by sending information. Your brain can play tricks on you, because people who have taken acid, LSD and stuff like that, they see things that are not there. And the brain is trying to make sense of the information that it's receiving from the outside world. Everything we see is an illusion. And what I mean by that is, it's an illusory image that we see. We look around in our rooms, that visual information is being transformed into digital or electronical impulses inside our brain in darkness. And then our brain, based on our beliefs and everything that we know, does its best to reproduce a picture in the back of our minds that we can actually see of our environment. So it's a projected image that our brain has created. Some people who do drugs like LSD and stuff like that, it's interrupted. Those signals are interrupted, and then the brain is like, hey, I'm going to throw a freaking mouse in there and a lion or whatever it throws in into the mix, because it doesn't know what to do with the information because it's interrupted. So people can see things that are not there because of brain chemistry or what's going on in the brain. But I know what I saw. I saw that thing down in those caves, and I had somebody standing with me, and I'm glad I didn't know that woman, because that meant to me that we had nothing in common, no connection, and she saw the exact same thing, which verified that I did see it.
Mm. And you earlier said that there's things that can be done, and tell us about that.
Can you elaborate on the things that can be
done? Like in terms of like ceremonies in order to improve, to get rid of these things. Like, what did you mean by that?
Yeah, well, we went to a Buddhist temple in Massachusetts, and they have a ceremony there. So when people are suffering from sleep paralysis with the supernatural presence, and they can go to these monks, and these monks will say prayers over the people. They will do like a water ceremony, and they it's really cool. They drip hot wax into water, and they burn incense, and they just pray over the people to give them a sense of calm. What's strange about it, when I went into that, I've never been into one before, but when I went into the temple and we shot the footage in there, after feeling all of the energy in there and the chants and all of that going on, when I walked out of there, I felt like I had, you know, taken some sort of a drug to totally relax my body. I felt so calm on the way home. It was as if I had just been myself. I'd been blessed or cleansed by these monks. But so that's one. They have ceremonies like that. In the Islamic faith, they have similar things, but then they have the exorcisms that they perform, which you can see those online. When somebody thinks that a jinn is in their home or troubling them, they can go to these imams, and the imams will perform these ceremonies, these exorcisms over the people. There's plenty of those on YouTube you can look at. And then on my DVD, which if anybody buys the DVD, there is a prayer on there, Islamic prayer, that came from the UK. And if you have a jinn in your house or you've seen a jinn, you play this, you put on the TV, you turn it up full and you play this prayer, and it's supposed to cleanse the house. And that's on the DVD.
Yeah. And you live in America, do you, Paul?
Yeah, I came over here in 2006.
Okay. Yeah. What took you there then?
My wife.
Okay.
She came to, she lived in Uxbridge with me for 2 years. And then we decided to go to the States. We had bought some land that we were planning on one day, you know, coming out here and building on. And circumstances changed, and we decided just to go and do it, you know. So we came out here and built our property, and we've been here ever since.
Oh, fantastic.
Yeah.
And now what's I'm
a citizen now, so.
And so what's your lifestyle like? What do you do day to day? Do you work or?
Yeah, we have a company online. We sell nutritional supplements and teas and powders and natural oils and stuff like that. It's all natural stuff, and we've been doing that for well over 6 years with our company. And previous to that, I was with another company I started with a friend of mine, and we spun that company up, and then I moved away from that and we started our own up here. So that's what we've been doing for the last 6 years. But prior to that, I was into video production and multimedia. That was all I did for a load of companies over in the States and in the UK.
Mm. And what's your wife's point of view on all this stuff? Has she had these kind of experiences?
She hasn't had these experiences. She's intrigued by it, and she, you know, she doesn't dismiss it. She's very open to it. She's definitely open to the spiritual side of things, because she gets a lot of you know, these readings done, which I don't like doing. I don't like people, you know, reading my future or anything like that, or telling me about what's going to happen. But she's into all of that stuff. But no, she's behind me. She's supported me all the way with this, and it excites her. She loves, you know, being around this and hearing about it and watching me do what I do.
And what other How else does your spirituality manifest? Like, what other stuff are you into besides this sort of particular topic?
Well, it started when I was younger, like I said, with ghosts and paranormal. My first book I saw, I cannot remember the title of it, but it was a little illustration book, all color illustrations, and it was about 6 inches by 8 inches tall, and the book had a skull on the front. You can actually find, I'm going to send you a picture of it, because that's what started my journey. And this little book had all these types of things in it, like ghosts, poltergeists, UFOs, demons, and each chapter was a beautifully illustrated section telling you all about these things. And from there, I kind of got the bug, you know, I wanted to find out more about this. And then I started getting videos out from the video shops used to have in England, and watching all of the things I could. And then was it the 90s or the late 80s, I think it was, or early 90s, a show came on TV in England called Strange But True.
Yeah, I remember.
With Michael Aspel. Mm. And that kind of got me reignited into the whole paranormal thing. I still watch those online. They're on YouTube. They're really good, the way they put them together. Mm. And that's kind of the way I based my documentary, on the Strange But True format, with reenactments and stuff like that. But so I've kind of ghosts, poltergeists, all of that stuff. And then I went into UFOs when all of that started coming out, when Nick Pope came on the scene and they started to, you know, talk openly about UFOs in the 90s. And then I kind of, when I came over to America, I ended up in a paranormal group as the videographer. And I caught some amazing stuff on camera.
But, really?
We were filming in a place called the Wilton Historical Society. And that's not far from where I live now. And I actually I set one of the cameras up, and you see these pair of legs walk right in front of the camera, but they're not solid legs. They're almost like static the way, but you can see the legs walking across the camera. And I got that. We got the usual orbs and stuff like that. But that's kind of how I got back into it over here. I ended up then 2007, I wanted to make my documentary film based on my experience with sleep paralysis. And I ended up going down that path, which led me to supernatural assault, you know.
Mm. And what does your future plans, like, are you going to do more documentaries, or what is it?
I am going to do them. I don't know what way I'm going to do them. I think I might go the mashup route from now on. It's a lot quicker. It took me 1 year to make that film, Supernatural Assault. It took a whole year of my life. It took me away from my business. It really was a risk that I took making it, because the time involved, the money involved, it was a lot. I think if I go the mashup route, but you know what that is, right? You just grab clips off the web and slam them together in your own interpretation of.
I see.
Yeah.
And you essentially do a voiceover of other footage.
Correct. Yeah. Like they have on YouTube, those documentaries that people put together. I think that's the route I want to go moving forward. And I just want to go that way, because I just can't devote a year of my life to making one documentary anymore. And there's not really any big money in this. It's, you know, it doesn't pay off. You make something and it's for personal satisfaction. But, it's a nightmare trying to sell it. once you've got it made, trying to sell it is the hardest part. Mm-hmm. You know, everybody would be jumping all over something like this, but it's a slog. But that's why I think if I do mashup videos, I can put them out quite quickly and not make those same sacrifices.
Who are the people that you look up to or admire or respect that are working in this field?
Well, one of the people that we interviewed, Rosemary Ellen Guiley, I went down to her home in Connecticut and interviewed her. She's a really lovely person, and she was gracious enough to help out in the film and give me some pointers and information that I hadn't yet found out. But she's one of the people in that area, in this area that I really respect. I think she's a great resource of information, and she knows her stuff. And then Dr. David Hufford, he as far as sleep paralysis goes, he's a really good source of information, really nice guy as well. So there's other people that I've seen on, over the years I've seen, but those two stand out to me because I personally worked with them.
Do you ever find yourself in situations where you just don't believe what someone is saying? Like maybe somebody's telling a story, but you just know they're making it up. Has that ever happened?
Yes. Yeah. And the people, what gets my sort of spidey senses going on somebody is when they say they've seen everything. You know, you meet those people that say, yeah, I saw a ghost and I saw an alien and I saw a UFO and I saw this and I saw that. Those type of people, I can't say that they didn't see it, but it kind of gets me thinking, hey, are they for real? You know, that's the only thing that kind of gets me. If someone comes to me and they're adamant, hey, this happened to me, and they're very, fixed on that particular thing, I tend to believe more. I tend to believe their stories more than somebody who claims to be to have had every experience possible.
Mm. What I don't understand is people who just automatically dismiss everything as being not true. Like, that's damn arrogant, isn't it? To think that you already know everything, you already know how the universe works, you already know what's true and what's not true, and, that's nuts, isn't it?
It's ignorance. It's absolute ignorance. Now, I may sit down at MIT with the brightest minds in America, and they might laugh at me and say, I would just say to them, listen, guys, you don't know nothing. You don't even know what goes on in the universe apart from the small bit that you can measure. So who are you to say that this stuff can't be for real, that it can't happen? They just don't know, but they will laugh at all of your ideas because it embarrasses them. They just, because they can't understand it, they just laugh at it. That's ignorant. I think that there's more to this universe than we know and that we'll probably ever know. I mean, it's just complex. I mean, I've been watching some DVDs, some films on Facebook, on YouTube, that are really testing my beliefs. And, this is this week, and I'm like, what's going on? But I can't dismiss it. I'm looking into it hardcore, and I want to find out more about it.
Is there any university stuff that is studying, what do you call it, like parapsychology? Is there any government stuff going on in this field?
Yeah. They're actually studying this in some of the universities. This is how we met Dr. Hufford.
Okay.
They've got a department set up down there in his Penn State University. I don't think he's there anymore, but when he was there, they used to look into stuff like this, sleep paralysis and past lives and stuff like that. So they're definitely looking into it. They're not dismissing it.
Yeah. Oh, it's fascinating stuff. Do you have any final thoughts or things you want to say to our listeners before we wrap up?
Well, I would just say to them, if they have an interest in this type of thing, to check out the website, which is darkelementfilms.com. You can read about the documentary and you can, watch the trailer. And if you want to view the movie, you can actually stream it. And, just remember that these people's experiences are real. Some people have encountered some really horrific stuff, and there's something that we didn't even talk about today, which I think is quite interesting, was the story of Dawn Howley, who was featured in the film as one of the interviewees. I don't know if you saw, Ben, towards the end of the documentary, there was a In Memory Of page that came up.
Is that the credits at the end, was it?
Yeah, right at the end, we dedicated the film. There was a lady in the film, and she said that she was being plagued by these shadow people, these shadowy forms. And one of them grabbed her arm and pulled her as if it was trying to drag her over the back of the chair. Mm. she was terrified anyway. She was crying and terrified. And when I said to her, I said, you know, why are you getting so upset over this? I've seen these things. It didn't have that effect on me. She goes, they're actually in her home and she's terrified. And she said that I'm terrified. They're going to kill me. They're going to try and kill me. And what's bizarre about that is after we interviewed her, a while later, we got a telephone call to let us know that Dawn was actually found dead in her apartment or her home. And when we inquired about why she died, nobody knew. They said it's natural causes. She was only 54 years old. That's the last I heard. Maybe, I don't know if they found anything since then, but the last I heard, she died of natural causes. So we dedicated the whole film to her in her memory. And her encounter is in the film. She had a couple of encounters. They're both portrayed with reenactments in the documentary film.
You know, that reminds me of another story, Phil Schneider. Did you ever see that guy on the internet?
Speak about it so I can kind of...
He's the guy that claims he was in a... He was working for the government building underground military bases, and he was on the basically the drilling team that was he was part of the engineering team constructing these underground bases. And he claims that they stumbled across like an underground base, basically an alien base. And he reckons he got into a shootout with these aliens that were down there. And he said they zapped him with something. That basically burned his fingers off, and he holds up his hand. He's got no fingers. He's got like two fingers or something.
Well, at least he's got evidence, you know.
Yeah, and he said the government they were trying to kill him. They were trying to shoot him, and then like a little while later he died. I can't remember the details, but I can't remember all the details. I don't know if he got shot and he had the something like that.
I'll look him up. I mean, there must be something on YouTube about that. I'll look that up, see if I can find it. I hadn't heard of that before, no.
And with him, he struck me, like you were saying earlier, you can just tell when someone's making it up or when they're not. You can just tell when someone's telling the truth. And he struck me like that. He was just telling the truth. This was not a lying man. This was not a fibber. You know, this was not an attention seeker. It just didn't come off like that. He came off like a legit, credible guy, you know?
Wow. Yeah, that's interesting. I never heard of that guy or his story. I mean, I've heard a lot of stuff. I mean, this is all I listen to on YouTube. I go, besides the political stuff, is I look into stuff like this.
Mm. Yeah. One more thought. Have you got a little bit more time, Paul?
Yeah, I've got as much time as you need.
One more thought. Is there any like positive examples? Like, are these entities ever being helpful?
From the people that I interviewed, I can't think of any positive stories. I'm just racking my brains because I don't want to misquote myself. But no, I can't think of any positive stories. I'm not saying there are not, because, you know, with relation to the jinn, you know, it's said that there are good and bad jinn. There are those that love to help people that, you know, and they're considered like guardian angels. And then there's the malevolent ones that are terroristic. But I don't personally have any stories of anything positive happening myself with any of these entities.
So is it possible that the angel is like a good natured version of the same thing?
No, it's funny you bring that up, because they say that in the beginning there were only angels and jinn on the planet Earth, according to the pre-Islamic writings, and they've adopted it into their religion. They believe that there was only angels and jinn, and then man came along, and that's when the trouble started. And the jinn were apparently banished out because they refused to bow down to man and their leader Iblis. This is what's written. This is actually written in their culture. Their leader Iblis wasn't happy and ended up that the jinn were you know, banished from this realm, this dimension that we call, you know, Earth, the five sense reality that we can see. They're gone from that. And apparently they're not happy about that. So that is said to be one of the reasons that they torment humans.
Yeah.
I don't know any truth to that, but that's what's written.
Are you Muslim yourself?
No.
Okay.
No. I was raised Roman Catholic.
Okay.
And then kind of, I kind of moved away from it. Not because I didn't like it, it's just because my mum used to force me to go to church on Sundays when my friends were playing football and I used to get pissed.
Yeah. So
that's kind of one of the reasons. And then I just kind of, as I left school, I went to Roman Catholic schools, and when I left school, that was kind of the last. The only time you caught me in a church was for a wedding or a funeral. But I was raised heavily Roman Catholic. I'd done the, you know, all of the things, baptism, communion, and confirmation. So, but yeah, that's my religious background.
Okay. Well, Paul, that was a fascinating conversation. Thanks ever so much for coming on the podcast. Anybody who wants to check out your documentaries can go to, just remind us one more time.
Dark Element Films with an S, films.com. Darkelementfilms.com.
Fantastic. Thanks ever so much. And we'll stay in touch, and I look forward to seeing the stuff you do in the future.
Okay. Take care, Ben.
All right. Bye, Paul. Bye.